is a member of the Mexican Council on Foreign Relations and a specialist on all of these topics. Lila, good morning.
Agustin, good morning. I'm so happy to be here.
So what's really going on, or does anybody know?
Well, I mean, I hope that we know something, right? I think that we have some positive remarks in the fact that of virtual president-elect Andres Manuel López Obrador. His members have been in D.C. this past week with the continuing negotiations for NAFTA. I think that they're presenting kind of a vision of continuity, which I think brings a lot of stability for Mexico. I think that presenting a united front on various issues and allowing the current negotiation team to kind of go forward with what they've been working on for the past year, I think that's very positive. And I think the remarks that Lighthizer has said about, you know, concluding these negotiations at the end of this month, well, presents a really good, you know, kind of like base for what we can expect going forward. There is kind of a division, right, in time. So the negotiations can be completed by the end of this month, but Congress does have to go through consultation for 90 days, go through legal proceedings and whatnot. So if we do carry, if we put that November 25th could be the end of negotiations, we are looking at November 25th for an actual, you know, completion of this negotiation. And then Enrique Peña Nieto could potentially sign the final
NAFTA. But that's on the executive side.
That's on the executive side.
And there is a legislative element that we're not taking into consideration. So they could actually get together for the picture, all the signatures, and, you know, and pretend that life is good. But at the end of the day, there are three legislatures involved.
No, completely. And I think the elections in November in the United States are going to be, you know,
the
very important. The legislative elections. They're, you know, it's probable that the Democrats will take the lower house, you know, the House of Representatives. And I think that that could pose, you know, certain threats or certain reversal of some of the negotiations that we could be seeing in these next couple months.
Right. If the Democrats take the U.S. House of Representatives, then we could actually see no agreement in that particular house. You have to understand, our viewers have to remember, for Mexico and Canada, the NAFTA is an actual treaty. For the United States,
it's an agreement,
which changes everything. And what it means is that they don't have to go to the Senate and get that two-thirds majority, but they do have to go to both houses, including the lower house and the House of Representatives, to get the agreement with a simple majority, right?
Exactly. And I think that's very interesting. Just December 1st here in Mexico with the new president, then a new team comes in. I mean,
September 1 will be the new legislature in Mexico, which is also going to be a radical change.
Huge radical change with a majority of the
December
new party.
And December 1 is going to be the new president.
Exactly. And I think that the fact that there are members of the current transition team as observers in these negotiations is key. But then again, they have presented a variety of different, like, visions of what they see with the negotiations, right? So they've said that they're a bit flexible with the rules of origin and that they're more flexible with conflict resolution issues. And
that's
although
more flexible vis-a-vis the outgoing administration,
right? I mean, that's just like a perspective that they've offered. Of course, the current negotiation team is the one that's kind of, you know, really pushing forward with what their vision has been for these past negotiations. Ooh, negotiation team here in Mexico, you know, there will be a shuffling of ideas and negotiations.
My perception is that people are being overly optimistic because there are too many factors involved. But there was one thing that came up right at the beginning of when Marcelo Ebrard's team took over, and they're in lockstep with Luis Videgaray and his team and Ildefonso Guajardo and his team. They're certainly a huge change, obviously, in terms of administration, but it would seem that they've been talking and working together for a long time. I mean, they are in lockstep, right? And I just want to I want to mention one thing that sort of came up. There seems to be some sort of a grand bargain out there, and it got picked up by the Washington Post, but then there was no mention of it. And that's this idea that Mexico could become a safe third country to receive the Central American refugees, such that these would not be arriving to the United States. And given the fact that this is an ethno-nationalist government in Washington, that what it cares about is it has having fewer immigrants in the United States, especially from Latin America, then it would seem that Mexico could offer that in exchange for being left for the bullying to stop, so to speak.
Right.
What do you think of that?
So for the first part, I think that we're showing more statesmanship and more continuity than the Trump administration is, right? Where you have like all these diverse ideas and going around. And with the Mexico team, you know, they've shown so much discipline, regardless of whether their parties are completely different ideologically. I think going forward for this negotiation, they've presented a very united front. And I think at the end of the day, who wants to be benefited is Mexico. And I think that's what they've been demonstrating with
independent of the fact that a center-right administration is leaving and a center-left administration.
Exactly. As far as the Central American issue with migration, I think Andrés Manuel López Obrador has been very clear about his plan for the Northern Triangle and also other Central American.
Define Northern Triangle.
So it's El Salvador, Guatemala,
Honduras,
You know, and this triangle has presented, you know, a lot of delinquency. They have a lot of problems with border security. They have a lot of problems with development.
Gang violence.
And it's one of the most violent, you know, regions in the world.
Right.
And I think that this migration issue that Andrés Manuel López Obrador has pointed out to Donald Trump as well is that we have to work to develop and to, you know, bring economic prosperity to this region. At the same time that there has to be an enforcement of security and, you know, to deal with these gang violence issues, but there has to be a background of development and economic prosperity that has to be coupled with security so that they can grow and so that migrants are not going, you know, to the United
States.
So
the grand bargain here, if it is in line with what we read in that Washington Post article, and what was kind of said, because when Luis Videgaray got together with the foreign ministers of Central America at the same time that talks were going on between the incoming Andrés Manuel López Obrador administration and the Trump administration, that would be the idea. Mexico takes care of the immigration issue, and the way that ties into NAFTA is because the grand bargain would be, okay, so now now that we've dealt with one of your main problems, now you can leave us alone and be more reasonable with respect to NAFTA.
Right, and I think that Andrés Manuel López Obrador also has pointed out that he's willing to present an initiative to Congress so that he can have a budget for these issues, right? He's not just saying we're gonna combat them and kind of leaving it in limbo. He's really kind of putting money to where is needed and presenting an initiative that, you know, makes sure that all these issues are covered. And I think that that's a very good position going forward with negotiations for NAFTA and also cooperating with the bilateral relationship with Donald Trump. The exchange of letters that both leaders have exchanged, I think, has been very positive in the sense that they've recognized key issues, right, like trade and security
and economic development.
And I think that the fact that they're, you know, being very clear about how each are going to go forward.
We'd be remiss if we did not mention the fact that part of the reason why there's such great communication between the incoming administration and Donald Trump's administration is the fact that Marcelo Ebrard hired when he was governor of Mexico City. They say mayor, but in reality he's more like a governor. Hired Rudy Giuliani, who's one of the closest people to President Trump, that many years ago. I mean, you're talking about 16 years ago, and gave him upwards of $4 million to help with the security issues. So there seems to be a direct dial there.
And that's interesting that you mentioned that, right? Because so many people focus on the fact that Ebrard was very close to Clinton, to Hillary Clinton's team.
But actually,
you know, there's this other side where he did hire Giuliani while he was in Mexico City as governor. And that has also, you know, kind of brought this closeness in the relationship. I think that they're working together to bring this to a close. I think the United States also is very interested in signing this. I think Freeland's visit to Mexico, from Canada to Mexico has, you know, also shown that Canada and Mexico are willing to kind of, you know, come together for these negotiations because they have more leverage.
Absolutely.
If they come together to kind of bring this negotiation to a close.
Absolutely.
So I see it very positive going forward. And I agree that, you know, this continuity and this united front of the Mexican team in the negotiations is present a good future for Mexico. And I think it's very clear how they're going to go forward.
So Lila Abed from the Mexican Council on Foreign Relations, COMEXI, thank you very much for
being
here.
Thank you, Agustin.
And a while ago, we had an opportunity to talk to the president of Arizona State University.